But, you know, I have a mother-in-law. But I'm going to leave it at that. I don't have I'm afraid I have no mother-in-law jokes. I have a wife. Okay. Mothers, you are wonderful. You may not consider yourselves wonderful, but you are. Where would any of us be without our moms? Probably wouldn't be here. I hope you all enjoyed watching that video this morning. It was kind of funny. I thought it was anyways, which might say something sad about my sense of humor. Now, we all laugh about the things that we hear mothers say, but there's one thing that I want you to understand, and mothers, you all know it. Moms want only the best for their families, and they're willing to do anything to see that they get it. Now, having said that about earthly mothers, I want you to know that we also have a Father, with a capital F, who wants only the best for you, your Heavenly Father. And today I want to see the characteristics that we see in our mothers, we also have in our Heavenly Father, in the God that has saved us. So let's take a look at how God works in your life to make you the best that you can be. Ephesians chapter 2. As for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sin, in which you used to live when you followed the ways of this world and of the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. All of us also lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our sinful nature and following its desires and thoughts. Like the rest, we were by nature objects of wrath. But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved, and God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that the coming ages he might show the incomparable riches of his grace expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. For we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. Lord, we thank you for your word. Open our eyes to see and our ears to hear what you are saying to us today. So, we know mothers, everyone has one. Whether they have a good relationship with them or not, that's irrelevant. Everyone has one. And we have a God as well. Whether we all admit it or not, we have a God. And God, like our mothers, sees us the way we really are. See, the first verse said, as for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins. And I am thankful that this is mentioned in the past tense. See, you were dead in your transgressions and sins. Since Paul is writing to the church in Ephesus, we know that he's writing to a Gentile church and not Jewish believers. And I'm not saying that Jewish believers at the time were not in the same spiritual dilemma as the Gentiles, but Paul just wants them to know where it is that they are coming from. As a mother knows everything about her children, God knows everything about you. Did you ever try to fool your mom? Did it ever work? My parents, they had a phrase they liked to use. They could tell us that we would say we were adding spice to our stories. And kind of got into bed down after that. I just went downhill after that word came out. Don't parents know the truth? God does too. And even more, he knows everything about you, far more than your mom or your dad might. Okay, he knows that you were bound by sin in your sin nature. You were dead in your transgressions, as the Bible puts it. And that was the whole purpose of Jesus coming to earth. Isaiah 53 and 5 says that, but he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him. And by his wounds, we are healed. See, we were dead in our transgressions and sins, but more than that, we followed the ways of this world. How many of you are leaders? I know there's a lot of you who are leaders in the business world. Some of you are brilliant academically. Some of you are just amazing within personal relationships. Whatever your field of study or endeavor you are in, you are just amazing people. I am honored to be among you. And when you're leaders, some of you can say, this is where I'm going. You can follow me if I want. And I always wanted to consider myself a leader. I know part of being a good leader is being a good follower, so I try to be a good follower too, but not like a good lemming. But, you know, even in years gone by, when I wanted to stand up for those who are less fortunate, who couldn't stand up for themselves, was I such a great person? Is that a noble mindset? Yay, good for me. Okay, don't be fooled. There was a time, believe it or not, when I can look back and I know that I was not a leader. I was following the ways of this world. I can know that if I hadn't started to follow Christ, then I would have wound up someplace far darker, far less pleasant than where I will be ending up with my final destination. See, the willingness to follow the ways of the world is a direct result of being dead in our transgressions and sin. That's what sinners do. Sinners sin. That's why they're called sinners. So we were following the ways of this world, and then we were living under the direction of Satan. See, the Bible says, the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit is now at work in those who are disobedient. Now, did your mom ever try, you might remember this from when you were younger, I don't know, that she might have tried to warn you about running around with certain people. Did she ever use the adage, choose your friends, choose your future? I'm trying to remember the one phrase I heard Pastor Stan use a lot. It was like, his mom said that it was, can Jesus go there with you? Is that the correct phrase? Can Jesus go there with you? I'm pretty sure I've heard that from him a number of times, and it's like, okay. Yeah. It doesn't just matter what your mom says. Sometimes older, wiser heads have good wisdom to pass along too. See, sometimes mothers know certain individuals are trouble for you. And God knows that if you're trying to live your life in your own power and your own authority, if you're trying to do what is right in your own eyes, you will fail miserably. Ephesians 6 and 12 says, "For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in heavenly realms." See, if you're trying to please God by what you do in the natural man, you really aren't pleasing him, because you are trying to fight a spiritual battle in the natural realm. You're working for the devil. See, even after you've left the life of sin behind, if you try to overcome the works of the enemy by fighting against him in what you do, you are walking according to the sinful nature, and you will lose that battle. You're either totally for God or you're totally for the devil. See, there's no middle ground. Throughout the history of Israel, we can see the stories of kings who knew gods, or knew God, rather, while worshiping foreign gods. They were not ignorant of Jesus, or God, Yahweh, Jehovah. But they still worshiped the Baals. They sacrificed their children to Molech. They still knew God, but they went and tried to have it both ways. They would even call upon the name of the Lord and seek his guidance from his prophets, but they were trying to have it both ways. And the Bible says that those kings did evil in the sight of the Lord. So, as a result, God knows what we deserve. Verse 3 of our passage says that all of us who lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our sinful nature, following its desires and thoughts, like the rest, we were objects of wrath. Romans 8 says then that those who live according to the sinful nature have their minds set on what the nature desires. But those who live in accordance with the Spirit have their minds set on what the Spirit desires. The mind of the sinful man is death, but the mind controlled by the Spirit is life and peace. The sinful man, mind, is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law, nor can it do so. Those controlled by the sinful nature cannot please God. Okay, moms, I know I see all of you out there. I know others of you who are not here right now, but I know of you. Okay, how many of you will admit to saying to your child, "This is going to hurt me more than it will hurt you"? That kind of somehow came right after the phrase, you're adding spice. You know that your child or children has done something that deserves punishment, and you know what that punishment should be, or at least how severe it should be, whether it's taking a plank off the barn and going at it, or just sitting on the hot seat. I don't know. Tried to avoid that first one. Habakkuk 1:13 says that your eyes are too pure to look on evil. You cannot tolerate wrong. So God is speaking about God. He sees that he cannot tolerate wrong. But even so, he still desires the best for us. Verse 4 of our passage says, because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved. You know, it says that God is rich in mercy. Do you know what mercy is? Mercy, many people confuse mercy and grace. Mercy is not the same as grace. We use them a lot, one after the other, and sometimes we make the mistake of using them interchangeably, but they're not the same. See, grace is when you get something you don't deserve, but mercy is not getting what you do deserve. So there has been many times in my life as a kid when I was praying for mercy. A lot of other times I was praying for some grace, but more often than not, I was probably praying for mercy because I knew what I deserved and it wasn't going to be pleasant. They said it's not going to hurt me more than it hurts you. I would argue that. Did you know the same word that's translated as mercy in this passage here is translated as compassion in other places in the Bible? See, God is merciful because of his compassion. He doesn't give us what we deserve because he loves us too much. He's still holy. He's still just. There's still that punishment out there for us. But remember what I said in Isaiah? That God came, Jesus Christ. He bore those curses, those transgressions, those sins were upon him. That's why he died on the cross for our sins in our place. Lamentations 3 says this, "Yet I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. Because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed. For his compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness." See, one of the great salvation passages of the Bible is Romans 5:8. Anybody know how to quote that one off by heart? I got chocolate in the office there. No? Okay. Romans 5:8. "But God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us." How can a holy God do that for a sinful man? How is that possible? See, God not only sees us as we are, he also sees us as we can be. God raised us up with Christ Jesus and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus. I love that verse. See, it not only tells us that God is done, but it tells us where he has placed us. We are raised to new spiritual life because of Christ, and now, right now, God has placed us in positions of authority with him. See, Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians 6 that a time would come when we would actually judge angels. It's talking about a time in eternity future. But God has done right now. He's placed us in positions of authority. He's done it right now, and it's ours. You see, God doesn't look at us with physical eyes and judge our outward appearance. It's probably a pretty good thing. He'd say I'm a pretty funny-looking kid. But he judges the heart and the spirit of man. See, if we're his children, then the Bible says that we are adopted into his family. Then Romans 8:16 says that the Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children. Now if we are children, then heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ, if indeed we share in his sufferings, in the order that we may also share his glory. See, he put us in a position of authority because we are now his children. So when we are praying for our new government, when we are praying for those we love who do not yet know Christ, when we are praying for illnesses, for people who are dying of disease, we're not praying in vain. We're not saying, oh God, please do this for me. Please, I ask of you. Please, please, please. No, not that way. We might start out saying it like that, but we also have to remember the fact that we have the authority given to us in Christ Jesus. See, we're his children. We're the king's kids. I remember when I was knee-high to a grasshopper, the little Christian Ed Sunday school thing was called the kids of the kingdom. And we are. We are the king's kids. See, God doesn't do stuff like that because of who we are, but because of who he is. And since we're his children, he intends to hold us to the highest standard. The standard that he holds us to is the one that he helps us to attain. See, in 2 Kings, there are three separate stories of boys who became kings. And one of them, Joash, in 2 Kings 11, was 7 years old when he actually became king. 7 years old. Do you know of any responsible 7-year-olds? I think it's a little hard sometimes to even find a responsible 17-year-old or a 77-year-old even. Okay. Obviously, a child like that could in no way rule the country by himself. And he was under the direct influence of the priest Jehoiada. But in two other cases, Azariah in 2 Kings 15 and Josiah, some of you know people named Josiah. I don't know too many Azariahs. I know some Joashes. But these boys were under direct instruction, the direct tutelage of their godly mothers. And God loves us that way. And he holds us up to a higher calling in the same way. See, like, these men, they were under the influence of their mothers. And when they grew up, they did amazing things. Like, they walked with God. Can you imagine a greater epitaph than that? Azariah was a leper, but he walked with God. He followed God. He followed God in all his ways. Josiah, he was in a kingdom so lost from God that when they found the Bible, the book of the law, in the course of temple renovations, they wept. And so he unleashed on that country a revival so great that the Bible says that it hadn't been celebrated like that since the days before, in the days of the judges. They hadn't been celebrated like that in centuries. Why? God loves us, and he holds us up to that higher calling. And when he pulls us in to following him, amazing things happen. See, Deuteronomy 32:9-12 tells us about how God watches over us in the same way that animals watch over their young. The verses say this: "For the Lord's portion is his people, Jacob his allotted inheritance. In a desert land he found him, in a barren and howling waste. He shielded him and cared for him. He guarded him as the apple of his eye, like an eagle that stirs up its nest and hovers over its young, spreads its wings to catch them and carries them on its pinions. The Lord alone led him. No foreign god was with him." But if we continue on in our passage, we find out why God responds to us in such a fashion. The Bible says this in verse 7, that in order in the coming ages he might show the incomparable riches of his grace expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. In the coming age, the time of the 1,000-year reign, and the eternal kingdom, that God will show us the incomparable riches of his grace. That's what God has in mind for the future. But it's more than just for the future. It covers the whole of history, from the time of his ascension to the time of his return. Verse 8 says, "For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, so that no one can boast." You're saved. You're amazingly saved. The word saved is in Greek is sozo, and we've used that a fair bit in the Christian circles. Have you been saved? Have you been sozoed? And people who don't know Greek go, huh? And that's okay. You don't know Greek. But This is what sozo means, okay? This is from Strong's Concordance, and it says that to save, that is to deliver or protect, literally or figuratively, heal, preserve, save yourself, do well, be or make be made whole. Are you saved? Wow. You're made whole. You've been delivered. You've been protected. You've been healed. You've been preserved. Isn't that amazing? All this is for one purpose. So we know that God knows us intimately, and he sees who we can be. But God already sees you as if it is already done. So we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do God's works, or good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. When I was surfing online in preparation for this, I came across an account by Dr. Ronald Meeks, who teaches at Blue Mountain Community College in Blue Mountain, Mississippi. He wrote this: I have not had the opportunity to travel much, but several years ago, my dad won a trip to Italy through his business, and he asked me to go along. A highlight of the trip was visiting Florence, the great city of the Renaissance. One afternoon, out of curiosity, I went to a museum where there were some works of Michelangelo that were displayed. As we viewed the half-finished sculpture of St. Matthew, the tour guide explained that this unfinished work was a prime example of Michelangelo's philosophy of art. He believed that in a stone there is a figure or a statue waiting to be released. The work of the artist was to free the statue from the stone. The statue was so lifelike that I thought any minute St. Matthew might just step out of that huge stone. And as I looked at the half-finished statue, I could see that the artist had begun to free the statue, but had not been able to complete it. The tour guide went on to explain that Michelangelo had numerous works that he had never finished. As I thought about God's work in us, I realized that God had begun a work in us to conform us to the image of Christ. However, unlike Michelangelo, God does not stop working in our lives until he finishes what he intends to accomplish. According to Philippians 1:6, God will finish what he has started. Ultimately, God has no unfinished works of grace. You see, God sees you as you are. He sees you as you can be, but he already sees you done. That's one of the benefits of God, because he's outside of time. He knows what you're going to end up like. He knows how you are. He knows how you began. But he doesn't leave us that way. He's seeing us with his eyes, and he sees not a chunk of rock. He sees an amazing sculpture, a trophy of his grace that is waiting to be shown to the world. Well, it's Mother's Day. How can we relate a mother's love with the love that God has for us? Isaiah 66:13 says, "As a mother comforts her child, so will I comfort you." A mother's love is so reminiscent of the love that God has for us. See, a mother will give everything for her children. How about this? God so loved the world that he gave his only son. He didn't do it for peanuts. He did it for you. Okay, a mother loves her children no matter what. I know sometimes children aggravate their parents. I'm a walking testimony of aggravation. I probably do aggravate my wife even, and she's not even a mother. But Romans 5:10 says, "For when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of his son. Much more, having been reconciled, we shall be saved by his life." Remember what I said saved was? Saved. Being protected, preserved, healed, made whole through his life. See, a mother will also protect her children. 2 Thessalonians 3:3 says, "But the Lord is faithful. He will strengthen and protect you from the evil one." A mother wants the best for her children. Isaiah 48:17 says, "This is what the Lord says, your Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel. I am the Lord your God, who teaches you what is best for you, who directs you in the way you should go." See, in the Old Testament, language, the word compassion comes from the word that means womb. The idea is one of birthing. Something new is being born. And whether it's a life coming forth from a mother or the new birth authored by our Heavenly Father, something new has been created. And just as the love of a mother bears that child through their whole life, so the love of your Heavenly Father will bear you through eternity by the love that He offered on Calvary through His Son, Jesus Christ. See, God sees who you really are, a sinner deserving of death, but He's offered you His only begotten Son to save your life. God sees who you can be, and He offers the guidance of His Holy Spirit to lead you and to empower you for the rest of this life. And He sees you as you already done. He ordains you to good works by His grace. Not your works, but His grace working through you. So, mothers, and those who hope to be mothers, those who are grandmothers, and all of us guys will take along just riding on their wings. 1 Corinthians 10:31 says, whatever you eat or drink, whatever you do, do it all for the glory of God. So God wants to work in your life to make you the very best that you can be. And will you let Him do it? May we pray. Our Father, we thank You so much that Your love is so amazing. You are our God. You are the one who loves us. You are the one who saves us. Father, we thank You for Your perspective that sees us as we are, sees us as we can be, and sees us as if it's already done. Lord, we thank You for that. Lord, we want to participate in that today, tomorrow, day after, day after, day after, on into infinity, because we love You in return. Lord, I just pray a special blessing upon each mother here, Lord, whether there be mother, grandmother, mother in potentia. Lord, just be with them. Bless them abundantly today as we give them honor. In Your name we pray. Amen.